Adam Flores, Martha Mulvany, thanks so much for joining me here on New Mexico in Focus.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
Now, your law firm sued the City of Albuquerque on behalf of several unhoused clients over policies and practices that created certain conditions for them and, frankly, for all unhoused people in the city. Martha, what were those conditions and what were your clients and others like them facing in Albuquerque?
So Lou, I just want to say that what this case is about is ensuring that the City of Albuquerque respects the constitutional rights of everybody in our community, and that includes people who have been forced by their economic and other circumstances to live outside because they have no indoor place to live. And we filed this lawsuit because what we learned is that what the city was doing is that it was criminalizing the presence of unhoused people anywhere with their belongings on public property, even though the city knew that these people had no place to be indoors. And in addition, the city was seizing and destroying their personal property, and that included property that's essential for a person's survival. It included clothing, food, medicine, tents, blankets, the kinds of property that we all need in order to live.
And the broader context is that there's a housing shortage in the city, and so there just aren't enough homes for to accommodate the number of people who are living in the city. And so as a result of that, there are necessarily going to be some people who have to live outside. And it turns out that the city's chosen method to address the crisis is the most costly and least effective method, which is criminal enforcement. And so what that looks like on the ground is police and sanitation workers will just descend on somebody who's camping outside and then order the person to move. And so people are just being shuffled around the city. Their belongings are being destroyed in the process. And the process just repeats over and over aimlessly without accomplishing anything. And so we brought the lawsuit because the city can make foolish decisions, it can waste public funds, but what it can't do is violate people's constitutional rights. And so we're just reminding the city that the New Mexico Constitution applies to people who are experiencing homelessness as well.
Sure. Now, those policies and practices that both of you just mentioned, are those still in place right now?
They are. The city's continuing to engage in these practices. We obtained a preliminary injunction from the district court, but it doesn't go into effect until November 1st. And so we've heard that the city is continuing to harass and cite people for their presence outdoors on public property and take and destroy their belongings.
Now, your clients won a victory in Judge Joshua Allison's courtroom a couple of weeks ago. And we'll get to some of those details in a bit. You've both mentioned some already. But every lawsuit, of course, has to have a legal basis. Adam, you mentioned the constitutional violations. But from the perspective of your case, what specific policies and practices are violating what specific constitutional rights?
So the core of the case is the New Mexico Constitution's cruel and unusual punishment clause. And the idea there is that, you know, it goes back to the housing shortage. There are going to be people who are forced to live outdoors. They don't have access to indoor space. And so when the city comes and responds to that by enacting a web of ordinances that makes it a crime to occupy every square inch of public property, which is what's happened. You know, you can't block a sidewalk, you can't stay in an alleyway, you can't stay in a public park, you can't occupy a public lot, you know, you can't erect a tent anywhere in the city. The result of that is that a person's presence anywhere becomes a crime. And so, you know, one of our named plaintiffs is Sonia Garcia. She recently was fortunate enough to get a hotel voucher, so she was off the streets for a couple weeks. But once that expires, she's back outdoors, living outside, sheltering outside again. And I can pretty much guarantee you, I don't know where she is right now, but I can pretty much guarantee you that she's violating some city ordinance right now because she has to be. And so that raises constitutional concerns for the city because you cannot criminalize a person's existence, which is what's happening. The second set of claims, which Martha mentioned earlier, are related to the destruction of people's property. And so these are real basic, you know, that we are all familiar with property rights and our property interests. So, you know, I can expect that I can walk down the street and police aren't going to seize my glasses and throw them in the trash truck, you know, or your pen or your phone or anything like that. But it's a process that's become normalized for people who are unhoused. The city, I think, thinks that their belongings are trash. Doesn't matter what they are, their blankets, tents, their medication, the documents that they need to access services, they're all subject to immediate seizure and destruction on the spot. So ordinarily, there are all sorts of procedural protections that people have from that. You know, you get a hearing before your property can be seized. You have a right to retrieve your belongings after they're seized, or a post-deprivation hearing after your property is seized. The city's practice is not to apply any of those protections to people who are experiencing homelessness.
Now, much of the focus surrounding this case has been on the city's decision to clear an encampment that was at Coronado Park. Now, keeping in mind the constitutional protections that Adam just mentioned, Martha, what happened at Coronado and what specifically did the city do there?
So what happened at Coronado Park is that for a long time, the city sort of passively permitted people to stay at Coronado Park. And then at some point, for reasons that aren't clear, decided that it wasn't going to do that anymore. So although people had developed an expectation that they could stay at Coronado Park safely, the city closed it without informing people that it was going to do that. It instead, the city had a practice of conducting cleanings every 2 weeks, and so it behaved it as if it was going to conduct an ordinary cleaning. But what happened is that the city came and started just seizing and destroying people's belongings. And even when people got out of the park and were trying to leave with their belongings, the city seized and destroyed their property that was out on the sidewalk. And then the city closed the park, fenced it off, and flooded it. And of course, the city is under no obligation to provide places for people to be. But if it chooses not to provide places for people to be, then it cannot enforce the criminal law against them.
Now, something that you've mentioned several times, Adam, is something that I definitely want to talk about, and that's the core contention that the city has made it impossible for unhoused people to be anywhere, and that city officials have criminalized a state of existence, as you've said. As Judge Allison put it in his order granting the injunction, everybody has to be someplace. Can you talk about that just from a basic human rights perspective?
Yeah, it really is. I mean, it's, you know, when you think about it in terms of cruel and unusual punishment or the legal standards, it gets a little murky. But the basic right is that you have to be somewhere. And if because of macroeconomic trends, you're priced out of the housing market and you're now being priced out of the rental market and you no longer have access to indoor space, you have to be able to access outdoor public space or else you cannot be anywhere. And so it really is criminalizing people's existence.
Now, of course, there are concerns from residents and business owners about the impact of the homelessness on the broader community. What conversation would you like to have, Adam, with folks who would contend that your lawsuit might make this longstanding issue even worse?
Well, I'd really push back against the narrative that, or the notion that the lawsuit is part of the problem or in any way contributes to the problem, or that the court's order contributes to this problem. This is a problem that the city created. This is a problem that the city can solve. And if this lawsuit went away tomorrow, you know, this lawsuit, which is designed to protect people's rights, went away tomorrow, that would have no impact on the housing crisis. It wouldn't eliminate the housing crisis, and it wouldn't reduce the number of people who are forced to sleep outside by one person.
Now, Martha, why isn't the city's public interest in maintaining safe and clean public spaces enough to justify some of those practices, the seizures, the removals that you mentioned earlier?
Yeah, so the city has tried to make that claim that it has a particular interest in safety and cleanliness related to unhoused people. But what the city's really trying to do is create a homelessness exception to the Constitution. All human beings create trash. Some human beings among every population commit crimes, and the city has constitutional ways to manage those issues. With respect to trash, the city has developed a comprehensive waste management system that works very effectively for people with homes. And the fact that it's chosen not to do that with respect to people who are forced by circumstances to live outdoors is a failure of municipal waste policy. It's not some inherent condition of homelessness. And similarly, with respect to crime, people who live in homes commit crimes, and when they do, the city doesn't clear entire neighborhoods or seize everybody's property. What it does is what it constitutionally is permitted to do, which is develop probable cause as to specific individuals regarding specific offenses and prosecuting them in accordance with the Constitution. And the city can take those same actions with respect to unhoused people.
Now, the mayor told me in May that this litigation was coming to a close. Clearly, that's not the case. What has the city's response been like in court, Adam?
I think that I actually saw that interview in May, and I think that the mayor doesn't take us seriously and doesn't take this issue seriously, which should be very concerning for everybody who lives in the city. This is not, you know, as I mentioned, if this lawsuit goes away, that's not going to reduce homelessness. That's not going to solve any of these problems.
Given their posture, what do you think that means for the prospect of policy and procedure changes?
I really don't know what the city is going to do. I hope that the city looks for proactive solutions, looks for other ideas other than criminal enforcement, but I don't know. I'm not sure what the city's going to do.
I just wanted to add, so of course, nothing about our lawsuit requires the city to take any affirmative steps to solve the homelessness crisis. But having people living outside in tents is not good for anybody. It's not good for the people who are forced to live outdoors. It's not good for the businesses, the residents, the tourists who would like access to those public spaces. And it's not good for the city that's going to have to be handling unhappy constituents. The only solution to the problem of homelessness is housing. And emergency shelter should be for just that, for housing emergencies. For example, if a person has to leave her home because of domestic violence, or if a person loses his employment because of an illness and is evicted, we need emergency shelters for housing emergencies. And in the meantime, if the city doesn't want unhoused people just living all over the city, the city would do well to create spaces where unhoused people who are forced to live outdoors can be and provide services. All human beings need access to toilets, they need showers, they need laundry services, and those kinds of services would make it possible for housed people and unhoused people to live more comfortably in the spaces that we share.
Now, a lot of our viewers will be familiar with big court cases that resulted in consent decrees, reforms in conditions in jails, prisons, police reforms. Adam, what comes next in this case, and is a long-term court oversight situation possible in the context of unhoused people?
Yeah, it's possible. Right now we have a preliminary injunction, which means that this order applies until the lawsuit's resolved on the merits. So there's a trial scheduled in the summer, and in theory the case could be resolved at that time, and then ongoing consent decree is a possibility, monitoring of some sort is a possibility. But at the end of this, if we prevail, there will be some order that ensures that the city has to comply with the Constitution when it interacts with people who are experiencing homelessness.
We've seen problems persist in those cases that have had consent decrees issued. Is there a reason to believe that a consent decree in this case would be effective?
Well, yeah, I guess I'm not. If there's a consent decree in this case, it would be effective because we would be monitoring and enforcing the consent decree. So, you know, just the attorneys and the civil rights leaders who are involved in the case would make sure that the consent decree is effective.
Now, one takeaway that we had while reading Judge Allison's order is that the city must do something now. And that's unprecedented in the context of this issue in particular. I'm not gonna ask either of you to offer a roadmap of what that might look like. It's not your job, Martha, that's the city's job. But What will this require in terms of a philosophical shift?
I think that the city needs to understand that it has a basic obligation to all of its constituents. That includes housed people and unhoused people alike. And as I mentioned before, nobody wants to live in a city where people are forced to live outdoors. It's in everybody's interest for the city to resolve the housing crisis. And to create emergency shelters that are only for emergencies, and in the meantime to create spaces where unhoused people who are forced to live outdoors can be and provide services.
Martha Mulvany, Adam Flores, thanks so much for joining me on New Mexico in Focus.
Thank you.
Thank you.